Good afternoon. It's Friday, the 15th of March, 2019, just after 1 o'clock. Welcome to UK Column News. Your host today, Mike Robinson, myself, Brian Gerrish. And we're delighted to be joined by David Scott with Northern Exposure. And of course, David reporting from north of the border there in Scotland. Where do we start?
Well, where do you think? I mean, most people will know the shenanigans that were going on in the House of Commons yesterday. So a number of votes taking place, mostly on whether to delay Brexit. Well, initially, the one vote that was lost, by the way, was the vote to have a second referendum, not because they're not going to have one, but because they've decided that it's not the right time. So what was passed was that there would be a delay in Brexit, and the question is, what will be the duration of the delay? Well, basically what's going to happen is that Theresa May is going to try and flog her dead horse one more time, sometime between now and the 20th of March. She's going to bring her deal back to the table and try to get it voted through again. If it passes this time, then the delay is likely to be 90 days or so while they get various bits and pieces, get their ducks in a row, as the saying goes. If her deal doesn't pass this time, Brian, then it's possible that we could be looking at a delay of a couple of years. Donald Tusk had this to say: the EU would be open to a long extension if the UK finds it necessary to rethink its Brexit strategy. So there you go. What do you make of that?
Well, I've got to come back to the fact that immediately after the announcement of Brexit, we said that it wasn't going to happen. We said there was going to be smokescreen, delay, obfuscation. And credit where it's due, they've all done a brilliant job to deceive the British people. 17.4 million people voted to come out. I think that wasn't the true figure. I think it was much higher. And it's clear that they are determined we are not to come out of this Fourth Reich organisation. I'm happy to call it that. Some people may think that's a bit strong.
David, welcome to the programme. What do you make of this?
I also call it the Fourth Reich because it's a German-dominated EU-wide superstate and kind of the Fourth Reich. I love Donald Tusk's comment. Yes, I am open to you paying my salary on an ongoing basis. How magnanimous.
Yes, indeed. Right. Well, of course, we've mentioned the fact that constitutional issues have been coming to the fore in the last couple of weeks. And, well, the Telegraph claiming an exclusive here, Geoffrey Cox's legal advice that Theresa May hopes will save her Brexit deal. And they're saying that Geoffrey Cox is attempting to win over Eurosceptic Tory MPs and the DUP with new legal advice stating that Britain will be able to break off from the Irish backstop under the terms of the Vienna Convention, the Telegraph can disclose. In the advice, the Attorney General states that Britain will be able to end the backstop if it having a socially destabilising effect in Northern Ireland, and that would be considered a fundamental change of circumstances under the terms of the treaty. Now, of course, that isn't the whole story by any means. And if you want to get the whole story, as Brian was pointing out on Wednesday's programme, have a look at John Bingley's paper on the UK Column website, Brexit, the Constitutional Position. Now, of course, this paper has circulated around Parliament. It seems to be sitting, certainly quite happily sitting in the in number 10 at the moment, we believe. It seems to have come back down from the top, and the whole issue of the Vienna Convention was raised by Jacob Rees-Mogg on Monday and also by Edward Lee. You know, the key point of this article here, which is not discussed by Jacob Rees-Mogg or Geoffrey Cox, is, of course, the standing army issue, which is barred by the Bill of Rights. And of course, that precludes us joining Defence Union, but they're not talking about that. What they have done, it seems, is they've cherry-picked John Bingley's article. They've realised that they have a possible option with the Vienna Convention. And it looks like what they intend to do is to try to use that to push through Theresa May's deal. We'll see whether that happens. But what we know is that Theresa May's deal is not Brexit. She says it is, but it isn't. because it's pretty much identical to what David Cameron was presenting in 2015 and 2016 before the referendum. And he was doing that from the basis of us remaining within a reformed European Union.
I'll just say somebody in the in our chat room, Mike, has said, please circulate this paper. And we would say, please do this, because it's a very, very important, it's very detailed, it's very accurate constitutional letter. We know that it's had a big effect in certain places in Westminster, but so many people in UK still totally unaware that we even have a constitution, and certainly they're unaware of the fact that constitution can protect us and protect us not only from wrongdoing by Parliament, we'll come on to that later, but also from the powers of the European Union.
Okay, now yesterday Jens Stoltenberg released the annual report for NATO this year, and it's very exciting. It outlines apparently how NATO is responding to today's security threats, adopting to new challenges, and investing in the future. So that's exciting. It covers NATO's activities and achievements to strengthen its deterrence and defence posture, to boost its efforts to fight international terrorism, to increase its capacity building support to partners, and to accelerate its modernisation and innovation agenda. And it also includes details of estimated 2018 national defence expenditures of all 29 NATO allies. Now, of course, only seven of those in that are meeting the defence spending targets. And that's a key driver for EU military unification, because if countries as individually aren't spending enough, it's being used as an excuse to drive for a centralised single point budget. So, well, what are they saying? They're saying that in 2018, half of NATO's exercises were open to partners and international organisations, including the European Union, either as active participants or as observers. The NATO Parallel and Coordinated Exercise 18 involved an unprecedented degree of cooperation between NATO and the European Union. And this is the key point, because as we look through this document, there's quite a bit about the European Union as a separate entity from its member states, which are also apparently members of NATO. So we seem to have duplication here. This is what the UK government says it has to be avoided with respect to military defence or EU defence union, that there should be no duplication. So we're in this sort of halfway house at the moment between nations being individual members of NATO and the EU being a separate legal entity, which they are also members of. Anyway, it goes on to talk about a Joint Intelligence and Security Division, which was established in 2017. This has improved civil military coordination within NATO. And this is another key point, because as we've mentioned several times on this programme, Jens Stoltenberg and Federica Mogherini, who is the High Representative for the European Union, have discussed on many occasions this business of bringing civil and military institutions together. And that's what they're talking about here now. So the Joint Intelligence Security Division has also improved civil military coordination within NATO, as well as intelligence sharing with the European Union and other partners. Now, Brian, I don't know if you've got any thoughts on the intelligence networks and how this works. This new entity, this new legal entity, the European Union, is now going to get access to NATO intelligence?
At a certain level, Mike, the thing is dangerous overall, because you can see that everything is being grouped together and shared. Military, police, intelligence, civil defence is all being pulled together. They are not talking anything about EU Defence Union, but this is coming together, and now with NATO. It is very dangerous. Nothing being said in Westminster, because there's a wall of silence over it.
Well, there is, but the wall of silence is only in this country, because you say they are not talking about it. Britain, we are not talking about it, but they are talking about it. Yeah. NATO and the EU are talking about this quite openly. So anyway, let's bring this article from the UK column on screen here. Military Union, British government policy since 1948. And what they say in the report, the NATO report, is in 2018, NATO and the European Union decided to further deepen their long-standing strategic cooperation. And they discuss the long-standing strategic cooperation. They say since NATO's creation in 1949, a number of different organisations have played a part in bringing security to the European continent, either as precursors to NATO bodies or as partners to the alliance. The Western Union and its affiliated Western Union Defence Organisation, for example, was created in March 1948 by the Brussels Treaty, and that's what this article from the UK Column website talks about. NATO goes on to say the Western European Union, a successor to the Western Union, existed from 1954 until 2011, initially a means of giving what became the European Union its own independent military capability. So they are talking about it openly. This is part of a long-standing, since 1948, a long-standing progressive program to bring the European Union its own independent military capability. Yeah. And they're well down that route. And, you know, this is from a European Union document. We pushed this out on Twitter already with some commentary on it. But these are the main pillars of European Defence Union. And what they say in their document is that European Defence Union cannot exist without all these pillars being in place. You know, bilateral cooperation arrangements between member states, which we've highlighted, the UK is right at the centre of this nest of bilateral agreements. That's on one side. And on the other side there, you can see core partnerships with NATO, including NATO. NATO went on to say that they welcome EU defence initiatives, including permanent structured cooperation and the European Defence Fund, as a potential contribution to fairer burden sharing. And this always comes back to the money. This is what's driving this whole policy agenda forward, because the headlines in the mainstream media about NATO's report are all about how only 7 member states of NATO are contributing the full 2% of GDP to the NATO budget. So without European military union, that's not going to change. But I've left the best to last. This is especially, I'm really looking forward to getting some comment from David on this one, because this is gender and counter-terrorism. The rise of violent extremism, often linked to terrorism, has prompted NATO to seek better understanding of gender-related aspects of the phenomenon. The integration of gender perspectives into early warning analysis can contribute to better situational awareness. NATO is also working with other international organisations. For instance, a joint NATO-EU workshop on early warning indicators was held in November 2018. NATO offers a wide range of related training and education opportunities and is developing a training module on gender in terrorism education. David, I don't know what you make of that.
What does that even mean? This is very, very strange because... Yes, the pushing of narratives, the pushing the politically correct narrative, and we must all think that like this, even though it's not true, even though what's the basic principle here? That men and women are different or that men and women are the same? It seems to vary. It doesn't seem to be at all clear. There is a reason that military forces are generally made up of males, right? There's physiological reasons, you look at the reaction. Every time I see a video of British police involved in a fight and beating someone up or getting beating up or what have you, and there's a woman involved, there's a woman officer involved, right? She's just getting in the way, with all due respect, when it really gets nasty. So what is this gender perspective? What are we missing that we need in order to understand terrorism?
Well, I think you have the answer to that, Brian. David, the attack on gender and the identity of a man or a woman, this is to break down society and society, communities and socially to enable it easier to control people. So it's an attack on both genders. But I think this is very dangerous that we've got NATO now trying to link gender to terrorism. I think this is part of the machinery to draw a system of military and policing as part of the rules-based international order. This is bringing it all together. Mm. You're mixing gender identity issues, which we see being pushed on the population in this country, in America, etc. Now you're mixing it in with terrorism, and that allows you to say, well, we've got to have this linked military police system through NATO and the European Union. I think this is very, very sinister. And I think this is the rules-based international order now starting to really show its colours.
Does it also mean that when conscription comes, women won't be exempt?
I believe that's the case. I believe that's the case. Well, look, we'll leave it there on this one. Let's move on to, well, if you remember on Wednesday's programme, we highlighted Boris Johnson's comments on LBC radio, just to remind you what he said. He was discussing policing, but then he got onto the issue of child abuse. And he said, we've spaffed £60 million up the wall investigating historic child abuse. David, I think it's fair to say that the response to this has been pretty clear. First of all, we have Sarah Champion here. Now, remind me, she's head of the all-party parliamentary group on this issue, is that right?
I would need to check on that. The MP for, she's the MP for Rotherham, and she's unique in that she is campaigning on this subject consistently. She has been disciplined, she has been demoted, she lost a position in the shadow cabinet, and she hasn't up. This is a very good sign. She says here, Johnson's attitude is appalling on many levels, and the impact on victims of child abuse has been immediate and very damaging. I know the survivors contacted me to tell me how deeply upset they were. And if I can just add to this, one of the talks that we organised in Scotland with the Fresh Start Foundation was a very fine campaigner from Birmingham called Shirley P. Cooper. And she explained the effect of the abuse that she had suffered. And she explained how essentially any exposure to white liquids could be very traumatizing because of what she'd been through as a child. The use of the word that was selected by Boris Johnson is not just insensitive, it's almost as though it was weaponized. It was selected to trigger, to attack, to warn off victims and survivors of child sexual abuse. It was absolutely, it was enraging that he should speak in that way.
But I've got to add, I think it gives us a glimpse into his mind. The subject is the abuse of children, and then he uses this highly sexualized, and it's obscene. If people knew what it really was, which most people don't, it's obscene. This is inside his head.
Yeah, well, we're going to find out what it actually is right now, because one of the things that Sarah Champion said at the end of her article was that there had been a unanimous reaction to what Boris Johnson said. Well, I just want to question that. So let's just have a look at what... So after the votes last night in Parliament with respect to Brexit, there were a number of points of order brought to the Speaker's attention, and the first several were on the Brexit issue. But then Labour MP Laura Smith had this to say.
Point of order, Laura Smith.
Allow me to make this point of order, Mr. Speaker. It is on an unrelated matter to today's proceedings, but I believe it is of the utmost importance. Yesterday, the Member of Parliament for Uxbridge and South Ruislip made disgusting comments on LBC Radio regarding historical sexual abuse and investigations being a waste of money. His exact words, Mr. Speaker, were spaffed money up the wall, a well-known colloquialism for ejaculation. I understand that the member did not make the comments in the House, but that should not place him beyond reproach. What advice can you give that I might pass on to those affected in Crewe and Nantwich as how to best proceed to hold this member to account for his actions, which in my opinion fall far, far below the standards expected of parliamentarians?
I thank the Honourable Lady for her point of order, and what I would say to her is twofold. First of all, she can, and I suspect will, engage with the member concerned, perhaps by correspondence, to register very forcefully her views. Secondly, if she wishes to approach that member directly in, I know, a very seemly but robust way. She can do that. And thirdly, what I would say to her is that she can send to her constituents a copy of the official report of today in which this very forceful and clear point of order from her and my response to it will be recorded.
So that was John Bercow's response to what she said. Now, the next point of order was from Scottish MP Luke Graham. And you'll understand why I'm showing these two in a second. Let's have a look at this.
Go on. Bless it out, ma'am.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I asked for your guidance on a security matter. Last night, two individuals approached my constituency office, banging on the windows and shouting at the one member of staff that was in there. She was on her own. She approached the individuals. She was told that in an independent Scotland, all of you will be hanging, and we will be there at the front cheering on. And also, I can't wait to come and drag you from this office and get you to the noose. Mr. Speaker, my member of staff was on her own. If she was here now, she would say she was a tough St Ninians woman who was happy to take him, but she shouldn't have to. Can I ask your guidance of what we can do in this House to stay as respectful as possible in this place and on social media, and what can be done to help the security of our staff in our constituency?
What I say to the Honourable Gentleman is that that behaviour was despicable and should be condemned unreservedly, as it will be by all right-thinking people in this House and beyond.
So there we have two points of order discussing two events, both of which happened outside of Parliament. One involved an MP making the most disgusting comments with respect to child abuse, and the other an MP complaining about his constituency worker coming under abuse from members of the public. One gets no comment from John Bercow, and the other gets some pretty vociferous comment from John Bercow. He went on following that to say that it was time that individuals were taken out of the criticism, that we criticise policies, we criticise organisations, but we should not be criticising individuals. And David, while I absolutely condemn anybody banging on windows and scaring individual people in it doesn't matter whether they're male or female in constituency offices, there's something pretty reprehensible about Bercow's approach here. He is silent on Boris Johnson, and well, as anybody that watches this programme knows and watches the closing titles at the end of the day, he who is silent is taken to agree.
Yes, indeed. And it is the contrast, isn't it? I mean, I wouldn't disagree with anything Bercow said about the people who were clearly unlawful. I mean, this is Scotland. That is very clearly breach of the peace, not just breach of the peace as a means of social control, but actual breach of the peace, causing people fear and alarm. Right. So that should be a police matter, and those people should be dealt with by the criminal justice system. But the contrast, the terms chosen by Boris seem to be chosen to cause intimidation and harm to victims of child sexual abuse. So here you see the Speaker of the House of Commons, even now, after all of the discussion, the debate we've had on this subject, all of the inquiries and claims of hand-wringing, and it's all in the past, showing still a complete disregard.
Absolutely. Now, David, just briefly, give us a little, just before we come back onto the issue of child abuse, give us the background why these people were shouting about hanging people.
Well, this gentleman here is Mike Russell, and Mike Russell is allegedly one of the intellectual heavyweights of the Scottish National Party, and he tweeted out that the Scottish MPs have voted tonight for the Prime Minister's awful deal, which would cripple Scotland and the constituencies, and he names them all, including the man who was speaking there. And then he says, hashtag Ragman's role. Now, that's a reference to the Scottish nobles who signed a paper to swear allegiance to Edward I of England in the 13th century. And
that was before Robert Bruce.
Before Robert Bruce. And it was signed in the Carnal House of Berwick, where the second largest city in Scotland had been torched and everybody living in it had been murdered by Edward's army, because Edward was a psychopath, as far as I can tell. And against this horrible background, these people decided that they had no option other than to sign. And then the political winds changed, the country found its ability to resist, and signing that became a thing of great shame, hence the term ragman's role. Now, this is one of the terms that's been bandied around, painting anyone who supports any aspect of the United Kingdom, any aspects of Britishness, an identity that Scotland has fully contributed to, in a similar vein. The other one that's used is Quisling. There's been Quisling, and the letter Q has been painted on Conservative Party offices in Scotland. Now, given the fact that the SNP policy is to hand over sovereignty and control to a German-dominated EU superstate on the basis that they maintain some local control under their tutelage in Scotland, I would suggest using the term Quisling is at least unwise. But the nature of the language and the nature of the hatreds and passions that are stirred up from the most senior politicians tend to be reflected on social media and out in the streets, where some of the more hot-headed members of their party and followers of their politics might react badly. So there is at least some concern that the ideology of the ideology of hatred and the ideology of concentrating the nation and painting those who you oppose as barely human, as subhuman, as things to be things you should feel disgust at, is a very dangerous concept. We're not debating ideas, and we're not exchanging ideas with a fellow man in a civil way. We're doing something else.
Yeah. Okay. Well, look, let's get back to the main issue here. Sarah Champion, in her article, also said this. Also this week, Lord David Steele, leader of the Liberal Party from 1976 to 1988, told the Independent Inquiry on Child Sexual Abuse that during his time as leader, he assumed reports of abuse by Cyril Smith, the Liberal MP for Rochdale, were true. Well, in fact, as we'll discover in a minute, it goes a bit further than that, doesn't it? But then today it's been announced that the Liberal Democrat Party have now suspended David Steele. David?
Yes, the Scottish Liberal Democrats have suspended David Steele. The statement is here. So following the evidence concerning Cyril Smith given by Lord Steele to the Independent Inquiry, Child Sexual Abuse on 13th March, the office bearers of the Scottish Liberal Democrats have met and agreed that an investigation is needed. The party membership of Lord Steele has been suspended pending the outcome of that investigation. That work will now commence. It is important that everyone in the party and in the wider society understands the importance of vigilance and safeguarding to protect people from abuse, and that everyone has confidence in the seriousness with which we take it. I'm sure we'd all agree with that. The revelations from the inquiry go on to find that Lord Steele, having concluded that Cyril Smith had been guilty of abusing boys in a children's home and abusing his power and political influence to gain access to those boys, assumed that he wasn't doing it anymore, and then nominated them for a knighthood.
David, it's incredible, isn't it? So let's have a look at how this thing unfolds, and we'll come to these points in a little more detail. But we'll start off with the BBC headline. Here it is: David Steele suspended by Liberal Democrats over Cyril Smith remarks. I chose one of their photographs there as the backdrop, because this sums up British politics, doesn't it? It's all jovial old boy network, where they're all upstanding, right honourable people. And on the left, we have the seasoned campaigner. On the right, we have the new boy on the block who's been brought in. Obviously, that's a very young steel in the picture. And the point that you've just made is this effectively what Lord Steele had to say was, it had nothing to do with me. This is utterly incredible. As somebody said a few minutes ago in our chat box, it's all coming to the surface, and I think a certain amount is. Let's see what he really said. Lord Steele said he'd assumed that Smith had committed the offences, but said he took no further action because it was before he was an MP, before he was even a member of my party, it had nothing to do with me. So it's almost as though if you get selected to be in a party, you immediately are in the boys' club and you're protected from anything that you've been involved in prior to that. These are amazingly deceptive words that are coming out from this man. And of course, everywhere we probe into politics in UK, we're coming up with the abuse of children. So let's go on through. He said, I had already told the inquiry in writing that in my opinion, he, Cyril Smith, had been abusing his position in Rochdale Council, that is to gain access to council run children's homes. But that had been properly a matter for the police and the council and not for me, as he was neither an MP nor even a member of the Liberal Party at the time. But the statement we're constantly getting from MPs when you take issues of child abuse to them is, it's not in my constituency. Mm-hmm. You need to go and see the MP whose constituency this crime is taking place. We've experienced this from many, many MPs across all the parties. They attempt to hide from doing something about criminality by saying it isn't in their constituency, or, it's not in my party. I'll bring you in a second, David. Let's just follow through a bit more. Lord Steele also described recommending Smith for a knighthood in 1988 and said he did not pass on any allegations about the sexual abuse of children because I was not aware of any such allegations other than the matter referred to, which appeared to have already been fully investigated. David, are we to believe that our MPs and senior politicians are so naive? I can't accept that. I believe that these people knew, they knew full well, they probably didn't want to get dirtied and touch the tar baby.
We come back to this business that he who is silent is taken to agree.
Absolutely.
You've got to ask this question.
Who were his colleagues back at this time? We had Clement Freud, didn't we? We had Jeremy Thorpe. We had the Fat Man. It was a very strange company, the Liberals at this time. Very odd indeed. The nature of the excuses, it's partly, yes, it's not my concern, I don't want to know, it's partly political cowardness, but also there's a strange legalising mindset. Oh, this has been properly investigated by the authorities, therefore I couldn't possibly comment, it would be inappropriate, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, many, many reasons to do nothing.
Well, we're going to have a look at some of the ways in which child abuse and the investigation of child abuse is shut down. But let's carry on with what this good man had to say. This is a little bit more. I'm reinforced in my view by reading the previous report of the inquiry sent to me today, which says, inter alia, the Crown Prosecution Service found that the advice which had previously been given could not be faulted, given the law and guidance in place at the time, and that the Honours Scrutiny Committee had seriously considered this nomination for a knighthood and sent a, quote, warning of risk letter to Margaret Thatcher as PM, and that clearly she took a similar view as he was granted the knighthood. So now the smear starts to track around. I thought he'd been doing something. Certainly I understood enough that he had access, was trying to get access to children, but not really my responsibility. But I did point it out to Margaret Thatcher, but she didn't do anything either. Therefore, it must be all right. So we now see the trail leading back into the Conservative Party and Margaret Thatcher. And as we'll see in a minute, we come on to Ted Heath. But David, this is becoming child's play to watch a political system absolutely squirming as more and more evidence comes to the surface that senior politicians have not only been abusing children, that their whole political system has been covering up that abuse.
Yes, yes. Oh, it seems to be the only thing you need is someone to blame it on. There's no other requirement. I have a minimum degree of plausible deniability. I will not actually be criminally convicted over hiding this information, therefore I hide it. Is that where the bar is? It seems to be. And I come back to it. He nominated the man for a knighthood.
Yes.
Correct.
This is just disgusting.
It's disgusting. It's as disgusting as Boris Johnson. And to me, his comments, yeah. So follow it through because we've got more to come. Let's go on. It's unfortunate that some sections of the media have chosen to extract certain passages of evidence and present them without the full context. The inquiry has a serious and sensitive job to undertake, and spinning evidence to generate sensationalist headlines only serves to distract from the panel's search for the truth.
But the panel isn't searching for truth.
I'm coming there, Mike. But here, what is he doing? He's using the key bit of now trying to turn the whole thing on its head. It's the nasty media who are spinning the truth by actually telling the truth. But as you've said quite rightly, if we take that last comment there, he says, evidence, spinning evidence to generate sensationalist headline only serves to distract from the panel's search for the truth. But the panel is not searching for the truth because the panel has said so. So we've got Ms. J herself saying this investigation is not examining the truth or otherwise of individual allegations. So I don't know why Lord Steele should have his knickers in quite such a big twist, because the panel is not investigating anything. Lord Smith, what is he so frightened of? I don't know. Well, let's bring in the leader of the Lib Dems, because he's been remarkably silent. I could not find anything reported in the media. Maybe I missed it, but I couldn't find anything where the leader of this illustrious Lib Dem party has commented on the matter. And David, I think it's very interesting that at least the party north of the border had the courage to actually say, well, you know, we're going to deal with this matter. Mm. So follow on through. If we're talking Lib Dems, we better bring in Nick Clegg. And remember that back in 2010, Nick Clegg was leading the tributes to, quote, larger than life ex-MP Sir Cyril Smith. He said he was deeply saddened to hear of his death. He praised the veteran figure, who was famous for his distinctive appearance and frequent television appearances. There's the nice link into the BBC. But a little bit later, 2013, we got The Guardian reporting that Nick Clegg ignored letters from lawyers where victims were coming forward and talking about what Cyril Smith had been up to. And then here we've got the Standard, when's that? April 2014, where Clegg is trying to claim that he had no inkling of Cyril Smith's repugnant actions. We are to believe that Nick Clegg led this very small party, where I'm sure nobody could sneeze without the rest of the party knowing about it, but he didn't know. And what now happens to Nick Clegg? Well, let's remind ourselves that he's now earning £1 million a year working in Facebook. And supposedly Facebook is now working hard to protect children. But Nick Clegg couldn't do that when he was in the leader of the party. So is he going to do it within Facebook? Well, I don't know. I had a little look at Facebook's commitment to child safety, and it's only child safety online. Mm. It's not actually protecting children. But it said down at the bottom of the block of text, for more information, visit Facebook's Family Safety Center here, which I did. But unfortunately, that page was not available. So probably
they're taking it seriously, then.
They're not taking it seriously. Well, here he is, Nick Clegg, July 2014. Allegations of Westminster paedophile ring are a police matter. Now, we know what happens when people report it to the police, such as John Wedger, a policeman himself. The whole thing is shut down. So basically, he's saying he wants the truth to come out and justice to be done. We're dealing with allegations of such a serious criminal nature. But a year before, he was saying he didn't know anything about it. Then there's comment from Lord Britton. Initially stated yesterday he'd asked officials to look into the issue, and he did not recall being contacted further about these matters by Home Office officials or by Mr. Dickens, George Dickens MP, who prepared a vast document on abuses of children by politicians. Britton went on to say the Home Office independent review is entirely consistent with the action I set out in my earlier statement. Whilst I could not recall that what further action was taken 30 years ago, the information contained in this report shows that appropriate action and follow-up happened. Well, if you consider cover-up appropriate, they did a very good job. Here he is, Leon Britton, the Tory who discovered Nick Clegg. So Nick Clegg was one of Leon Britton's European boys. He was trained up in politics in the European system by Lord Britton. This is a very, very close little relationship. David, just a brief comment, because I've got a little video clip that I want to show and then we can discuss it further.
Do I not recall the Dickens dossier, which exposed a good deal of this, ended up in the hands of a North of England local newspaper editor who was then intimidated by people, including Cyril Smith?
That is absolutely correct. But in fact, the worst intimidation came from security services and senior police, who told him that if he didn't get rid of his information, he was likely to have a very bad life. And of course, that journalist was happy to talk about this openly a couple of years ago. He was silenced by the state from exposing the abuse of children by British politicians.
That's the critical point. It's the state, it's the apparatus of the state is being deployed by people like Cyril Smith for their own ends.
Correct. So let's just have a look at this little video clip here. This is Sonia Poulton and Bill Maloney, who accosted Nick Clegg when he was in front of the cameras a little while ago. Now watch what happens. I'll give you the audio in a minute, but let's watch. Bill Maloney comes in from the left. He accuses Nick Clegg of not really doing anything about abuse of children. And just watch what Nick Clegg does. It should be here in the end of the clip. You'll see that very quickly he backs away, he leaves. Here we are. He doesn't want to discuss the issue, he's off. So what is it that Bill Maloney had to say? He said this: Nick, 4 years ago, I asked you what you were going to do about institutional paedophile rings operating in this country now. Your reply to me was, I don't know what you mean by institutional paedophile rings. So I'll leave our audience to think about that and Nick Clegg's reaction. But I was slightly, I think, upset to have a look at some of the Lib Dem material where they were reporting Lord Steele's membership suspension here. They'd closed the webpage to comment, so clearly the public is not to comment on these issues. But when I looked at the Lib Dem party itself, they're using this little image of a little girl to advertise the party. David, I saw this and I thought, is it me being a little bit oversensitive because of what's happened? Why would you need an image of a little girl in order to advertise the Lib Dem party?
I don't know. It's a very strange choice.
It's very strange, isn't it?
It's very odd.
Okay, now we're very short of time, but let's bring this in, because going back to 2013, the UK column produced an article asking a lot of questions about who approved Jimmy Savile's knighthood. And let's have a look at what we established, because this was done with a Freedom of Information request, because we asked for information about who nominated Jimmy Savile for a knighthood and the identities of those who offered letters of support. And the reply that came back from the Information Commissioner's Office was this. Thank you for your correspondence dated the 17th of January 2012, in which you state you wish to have disclosure of who nominated Jimmy Savile for a knighthood and the identities of those who offered letters of support. You've stated that the Honours Committee is, quote, unable to provide this information, which you believe to be in the public interest. And it goes on, the Cabinet Office administers the honours system and details of that process are published at the gov.uk honours website. It then says, however, honours committees are not directly subject to the Freedom of Information Act 2000, as the UK honours system is overseen by the Cabinet Office Honours and Appointments Secretariat. So they are above freedom of information. And finally, we were told this. Additionally, there's a specific exemption under Section 37 of the Freedom of Information Act in regard to information relating to the conferring by the Crown of any honour or dignity. And further guidance can be found on our website at the Freedom of Information Act Awareness Guidance number 26, Communications with Her Majesty and the Awarding of Honours and Nature of the Honours Nomination Process and the Public Interest. So we have got a secret system there running right to the monarchy itself, which is prepared to protect people who are known abusers and are given awards. This is a little bit obvious, in my opinion, David, that we have the full collusion of the state here.
Yes. The impetus that's coming to this, the motivation of the people, you have to remember what David Steele's great political achievement was. It was abortion. He was the man behind the Abortion Act. It's always surrounding children and it's never good.
Okay, well, we'll just introduce this as the last slide in this segment because it's so important. Several people contacted us this morning because they could not believe this. We've taken the Times report. Shamed politician's daughter has job looking after Rotherham abuse victims. The daughter of a disgraced politician who was implicated in the Rotherham sex grooming scandal has been placed in charge of a support service for the town's abuse victims. This is a charity that's receiving money from the council. The daughter of the disgraced politician who was implicated in the Rotherham sex grooming scandal has been placed in charge of support services. Nosheen Akhtar runs child sexual exploitation programs for Rotherham Rise, a charity that receives most of its funding from the council. Her father resigned as the council's deputy leader in 2013 after he was implicated in the scandal. And I think it comments on her brothers there, but I can't remember exactly what was said. Now, to me, this is the circling of wagons. This is people desperately trying to protect themselves.
Just as a final comment on this, David, while we're talking about Rotherham, of course, Rochdale, these are two areas where in recent years, Asian paedophile rings have been in operation and there's been a lot of scandal about that. But what Cyril Smith demonstrates, because he was Rochdale Council and Rochdale MP, is that the issue of child abuse in Rochdale has been one that's gone back decades before any Asians were there. So, the Asian paedophile rings could only have operated, and this has been a point that we've been trying to make for a very long time, could only have operated with the support of people within the councils and the police in those towns. Cyril Smith demonstrates that, doesn't he?
Yes, it takes a variety of failings to bring this about. It's not just one. One of the core ones is that the victims have to be viewed as culpable, as guilty, as human trash. And it's only when you view the victims as nothing that you can view the crimes in this cavalier fashion.
Okay, well, we've got a little bit we want to cover on free speech, but I put this slide up as just a statement because it's in our faces that child abuse and blackmail is the engine of British politics, the British political system. And that BBC film clip with the Conservative whip Tim Fortescue back in 1973 saying that MPs came to the whips with problems, including small boys, and they helped cover it up so that those MPs would do as they're told. That's the reality on BBC film.
Okay, David, we're pretty much over time, but let's talk about this. What's been going on with Gilad Atzmon?
Well, there's an ongoing campaign to silence Gilad, in fact, to drive him into the gutter, it would seem, because this is a campaign that's targeting his musical career. He's a very fine saxophonist, and there's an organization called Judas, a very far left wing Jewish group, who are organizing pickets outside venues where Gilad is playing. In one of these a while ago, they put forward leaflets quoting his horrible anti-Semitic sayings, and Gilad on stage explained where the quote had come from his book, and read out the entire quote. And it was an area which was a hypothetical that Gilad was looking and deploring and saying how awful it would be. And he took a little bit of text out of this and tried to pretend that the Atzmon had been advocating this, a complete reversal of the truth. So these people lie, and they're trying to silence Gilad Atzmon, and they're trying to remove his ability to earn a living because they don't like what he's saying. Now, they wrote to everybody in the council. They wrote to Diane Abbott and every councillor, and didn't get many replies. You see the Hackney Gazette reporting on this, and they're saying that members of the Jewish community are concerned, but they also quote Gilad, where he says, as an anti-racist, I will be delighted to be punished once they manage to find a single comment made by me where I criticise Jews or anybody else as a race, ethnicity or biology. So he's saying there's nothing in this, and the campaign didn't seem to get much traction. Then the police turned up at the venue, and they seemed the police were bemused because what's really happening? They didn't seem too pleased, too clear. The policeman himself was very pleasant, and they did say, well, if there's trouble, you know, you could lose your license. So the venue was under a lot of pressure. The venue is partly Jewish owned. In fact, one of the directors is a Holocaust survivor, and the people Gilad's playing with are Jewish musicians from America. So it's a very bizarre allegation of anti-Semitism. So the police had a look at this, and they've come back today to the venue and said, no, if it's fine, there's nothing in this, it's all bullshit, and we'll be policing, apologies for that phrase, we'll be policing any demonstration outside in the normal way. So the venue is standing tall, kudos to them for that, and the concert is going ahead as planned. And I believe that's tonight.
Excellent.
Okay.
Have you wanted to finish on?
No, we'll
leave it there. David, thank you very much for joining us. Thank you very much to people who've watched or listened in. We think things are coming to a head now in British politics. It's quite clear that, as you have said, David, we've got a government of occupation there prepared to condone, support, cover up criminal activity, whether it's financial. But let's come to the worst case. They're prepared to cover up the abuse of children, and they're prepared to create and prosecute those unlawful overseas wars. What are we going to do about this situation? They've got to be fully exposed. And I think we're now starting to see with Burko's reaction, they are getting fearful that the public is beginning to look at them and delve for the truth. But as you've said, David, our whole approach with these politicians must be above board. It must be reasonable. It must be persistent. But people falling into the trap of being abusive enable them to ramp up this deeply oppressive police surveillance state. So take these people on, but do it in a polite, reasonable, persistent way, and you're going to get a much better result. That's it for today. Please join the UK column on Monday. And if you're not a subscriber, please consider subscribing, because without your financial help, we can't do what we do. Thanks for joining us. Bye-bye. Bye.